Very warm welcome to the today's session. We have two speakers today. Sri Subramanya Hechan, he would be speaking on the topic how to time an event. And we also have Sri Kishok Kumar Chaturvedi. He will be speaking on the topic Secret of Planets Dasha in Vimshottari Dasha. Now I would like to briefly introduce both the speakers before we start the session for the benefit of all the attendees. Sri Subramanya Hechan, he is from the background of astrologer's family. Since childhood, he has been into astrology. His versatility in astrology hails from the childhood. He has studied in Indian Council of Astrologers, Indian Council of Astrological Sciences, and post that, he also persuaded in different branches of astrology, namely Nadi astrology and other branches of astrology. There are few things he has in to his merits. So he's also deeply connected with the spirituality apart from the astrology. He always tries to connect with the astrology with the spirituality as well. Apart from that, considering all his contribution to contribution in this field, so he has been given Jyotish Kalamani from ICAS. He has been honored with that title. And the past 20 years, he has been teaching in the field of astrology. So he has a rich experience he would like to share with us today. Another speaker, we have Sri Kishore Kumar Chaturvedi ji. He is a faculty member of ICAS Gwalior chapter. So his topic would be Secret of Planet Dasha Varsh. Sri Kishore Kumar ji, he has a master's in science from Delhi University. He's also done MA in astrology from Ranchi University. He has a rich experience in teaching in astrology. So he will take up the topic of Secrets of Planet Dasha Varsh today. In the meantime, I'll also welcome all of you to this session. Sri A.B. Shukla ji, our national president, also joined our session today. So I extend warm welcome to him as well. With that brief introduction, I request Sri Subramanya ji to take over the session and present his paper on how to time an event. So thank you. Thank you, Subramanya ji. It's all yours now.
Thank you, Vishwanath Holla sir. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir. Please go ahead.
First of all, greetings and good wishes to all of you on Amrit Mahotsav of Indian Independence Day. As Rabindranath Tagore rightly puts it, and I quote, "Where mind is without fear and head is held high, where the knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken my narrow domestic wall, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the very desert land of dead habit, where the tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where the words come out from the depth of truth, and where the mind is led by thee into ever widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, O my father, let my country awake." First of all, I am grateful to Guruvar A.B. Shukla sir and the entire webinar team for giving me an opportunity to present my paper today. I may start with two submissions. First of all, I feel humbled. At the same time, I am blessed that I am giving a presentation before an august gathering of my astrological gurus, masters and mentors. So if there are any mistakes, please excuse me. Secondly, what I am going to present today is known to one and all. I am not going to present anything that is new, different, special, or original. So my presentation may be devoid of glamour or frills and thrills of a professional presentation, but my intention is to inspire our young budding students of astrology about the vastness and richness of Indian astrology. I want to make them aware of the vastness and the richness, the depth and the width of Indian astrology, so that they can excel themselves in future. So with this, I will start sharing my screen. So I will commence with the musings of a yogi. In the autobiography Yogi, Sri Yogi Yukteswarji told his disciple, the child is born on that day and that moment when the celestial rays are in mathematical harmony with his individual karma. Every horoscope is a challenging portrait revealing his unalterable past and his future events. But the natal chart can be rightly interpreted by men of intuitive wisdom. So, the analysis of a chart is of two parts. Number one is static analysis and number two is kinetic analysis. Static analysis is the delineation or the analysis of the basic premise a chart holds. It is a delineation or the analysis of planetary dispositions, planetary combinations, yogas, and other planetary dispositions that indicate the probable future events of an individual. Kinetic analysis is the timing of events which I am going to present today. One should be very clear that one should never skip static analysis and jump to kinetic analysis. Static analysis is mandatory. Without static analysis, you cannot have kinetic analysis. Kinetic analysis is only the timing of events that is indicated by the static analysis. For example, a client comes to you and he queries about the marriage of his girl. First, you have to analyze the chart and see whether the marriage is promised in the chart. Only when the marriage is promised, you can go to the timing of marriage. So whether the marriage is normally it can take place, or it is a delayed marriage, or it is a normally delayed marriage, or whether there are any obstacles or impediments or doshas or shapas in the way of materialization of the promise of marriage, and if there are any remedies for the marriage, and if the chart, whether the chart responds to those remedies. So only a doctor can treat a patient only if he responds to the medication. So if the chart contains promise and has any doshas or shapas or any a remedy can work for it, then you have to first prescribe the remedy. So only after that you should go to the timing of marriage. So this is the majority of astrologers. It appears to be a very simple affair, very simple thing. Even if it's very simple, a majority of astrologers first skip the basic analysis, static analysis, and just they jump to the kinetic analysis of timing the event. This should not happen. So there are many systems of astrology. There are as many as 20 systems of astrology which I know. Parashara, Jaimini, KP, Nadi, Lal Kitab, Gurumurti Paddhati, Tally system, DNA system, Sadhu system, Shah system, TCSK system, Kaspal Interlink system, Unique Sukhmadasa system, Degree system, Akshaya Lagna system, Kali system, etc., etc., etc. Every system, every Paddhati or every system has its own unique way of static analysis as well as kinetic analysis. In this presentation, I am confining myself to Parashara and Nadi system. I am making it very, very clear. So there should not be any confusion. So you should not mix up with other systems. The only two systems I am going to touch today, one is Parashara and the other is the Nadi system. So for timing of events, there are multiple tools available. Number one is Dasha. Number two is transits. Number three is use of karakas. Number four is varshapala. Number five is chakras. Then number six is progressions. Number seven is band of years. Number eight is activation method. Then number nine is maturity age of planets and houses. Next, number 10 is advancement methods. Number 11 is Special Lavani Techniques. Number 12 is Ashtakavarga. Number 13 is Prashna. Number 14 is Numerology. Of course, there may be more methods. So out of these methods, first let us take up the basics, tools and rules. So out of the methods I have tabulated, every methodology or every technique has many variations. It is not as simple as this. Every methodology or every technique has riders attached to that methodology. Every methodology needs proper fine tuning to apply to the practical charts for optimum accuracy. Then every methodology has its own inbuilt intricacies and subtleties that can be explored only by a genuine student of astrology. Till then, every method appears to be enigmatic or obscure. Of course, every rule has an exception, but these methods give consistent results. They have been tried, experimented on a majority of charts, and they have been found to be working practically, but subject to these conditions. So one should go deep, one should delve deep into these methodologies to gain mastery over these techniques. It requires experience, expertise, and continuous practice on the part of the astrologer to get mastery over these techniques. This is for your information. Then we come to Dasha. Dasha is a unique concept of Hindu predictive astrology. It holds the key not only to timing of events, but also how the destiny unfolds through will link of time. Therefore, I have given the title Dasha as lamppost of destiny. There are three types of Dasha: Nakshatra Dasha, Rashi Dasha, and also very, very special and secretive Dasha, like Moola Dasha, Narayana Dasha, Padanadamta Dasha, which if applied properly can pinpoint the events with great accuracy. Learned astrologers and scholars suggest the use of multiple dashas so that one can close in on the timing of events. So it is better that you use more than one dasha so that you can be surer on the timing of events. This is better. Next, I come to transits. I have given the title Transits, the Illuminating Path. Transits actually form the core of all methods of timing. Transits are of many types. So you can use transits in different systems of astrology. I have tabulated in the above slide. But I confine myself only to Parashara and Nadi. Whatever it may be, Parashara or Nadi, the transit can never be complete without considering the essential parameters like Ashtakavarga, Karaka, Bhadaka, Maraka, 22nd Brekana, 64th Navamsha, Yogi, Avayogi, Dagdarashi, Special Bhavas, Navartara Scheme, CPPL, Divisional Charts, Sensitive Points and Degrees, Special Nakshatras, Rotation of Chart, Dasha, Antardasha, Veda, Latta, etc. So these are the different parameters. You should be able to correlate, synthesize and synchronize the results. It is the ultimate skill of an astrologer how he can use these different parameters, so these different tools, into his timing of event. So this is the skill of an astrologer. So without these parameters, simply applying the transits will never give you any results. Then the next I come to chakra. Chakra is an area or a field uncharted till date to a large extent. The reason is there is no extant or concrete material available on the use of chakras. Narpati Jayacharya in 1932 AD speaks about 84 different chakras. Just to mention a few, to give you an interest in chakras: Sarvatobhadra Chakra, Sudarshana Chakra, Shula Chakra, Surya Kalanala Chakra, Chandra Kalanala Chakra, राहु कलांदल चक्र कुंभ चक्र त्रिपाटक चक्र कोटा चक्र संगट्ट चक्र पाटकी ऋष्ट चक्र भृगु चक्र पद्म चक्र कूर्म चक्र मेरु चक्र रोहिणी चक्र सिंहासन चक्र सप्तनाडी चक्र पंचशलाक चक्र सप्तशलाक चक्र प्रश्न चक्र एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा. सो ई हैव ए वेरी स्पेशल इंटरेस्ट इन चक्र. When you speak of chakras, chakras are a very secretive tools of our rishis. For example, Surya Kalanala Chakra, Chandra Kalanala Chakra, Rahu Kalanala Chakra, they are particularly used in Prashna system of astrology for timing of events, both for static analysis as well as kinetic analysis. So, when I speak of chakras, I reminded of K.N. Rao, who in his literature says, first, he was initiated by great Himalayan yogi Mukhananda ji to work on chakras. Then he came across Hardev Shastri Sharma Trivedi, who worked extensively on chakras for more than one decade. Finally, the moment to reckon with came in his life. He met a pandit in Mathura, where he used Kota chakra particularly for timing Arishta. So then he realized that Kota chakra is a very, very effective tool for timing Arishta, for timing mishaps, misfortunes, disease, death, accidents, and other untoward incidents of life. So I think this Kota chakra is very, very useful for medical astrology. Then he has written another book called Tripathaki. Tripathaki chakra. So this chakra is very, very important in timing Arishta up to 24 years of age. So this is this variation of this Tripathaki chakra is Pataki Rishta chakra. So Pataki Rishta chakra is so powerful that it is actually used, it is a secret tool used by the Garhwal astrologers of the Himalayan region, where they predict, as the proverbial saying goes, hit in the bullseye, the timing of your Arishta in the lives of the children up to age of 24. It is written in the book that a child was admitted to the hospital and doctor declared that it is a very minor ailment and that the child will recover soon. But the astrologer said, no, this is the time is very, very critical, and as exactly predicted by that astrologer, the child passed away on the third day. In another incident, doctor said that the patient is very serious and he is going to pass away. But the astrologer declared on the basis of Pataki Rishta Chakra that he will recover, and he just recovered miraculously in just 7 days. So these are a few examples. I think there are many stalwarts and bigwigs of astrology in this August gathering, and I request them to take up a detailed research on these chakras and to come up with a comprehensive book so that it serves as a magnum opus of chakra delineation for the future generation to come. So this is about the chakras. So we are all conversant with the normal chakras like Sarvatobhadra chakra, Sudarshana chakra, and other normal chakras like Saptanadi chakra, Rohini chakra, Meru chakra, Kurma chakra, that are used for mundane astrology. But my intention is the chakra should be used more and more for natal as well as for Prashna. So this is more relevance to natal horoscopy as well as Prashna horoscopy. Then our degree of accuracy, our command over astrology, natal astrology, will really be at a higher level than today. This is about chakras. Next, another tool for timing of events is maturity age of the planets. So maturity age of planet is, you all know you are very, very conversant with this, but still, as a part of this presentation, I am also going to give a glance of the maturity age of different planets. Jupiter, 15 to 20 years. Peak effects will be experienced in the 16th year. Sun, 21 to 22nd years. peak will be 22nd, moon will be 23 to 24 years, and the peak age of that moon will be 24th year. Venus will be 25th to 27 years, and the peak age will be 25th year. Mars will be 28 to 30 years, and the peak age will be 28th year. Mercury will be 32 to 35 years, and the peak age will be 35th year. Again, Saturn 36 to 39, and the peak is 36. Rahu is 42 to 47, and the peak year will be 42nd. And the Ketu is 48 to 54, and the peak is 48th year. This is the maturity age of planets. In the same way, in our literature, it is also given the maturity age of houses. For example, 9th house will be activated up to 24th year. 10th house will be 25th to 26th. 11th house will be 27th to 28th. 12th house will be 29 to 30. First house will be 31 to 33. Second house is 34 to 36. Third house will be 37 to 39. Fourth house will be 40 to 45. Fifth house will be 46 to 51. Sixth house is for 52 to 57. And the seventh house is 58 to 65. Eighth house will be 66 or later. So this is the maturity age of the houses. So another very, very important tool for timing of years is the band of years, or I call it as ruling years of the planet. So just I told the maturity age of planets. So these maturity ages of planets are given in our classical literature. However, the cursed book Lal Kitab gives a band of year which coincided with the above maturity age of planets except for Mercury. So in addition, it was said that the same planet will rule the same band of years once in 35 years. So every planet has three periods. So three bands of years. So these three bands of years are given as below. Jupiter 16 to 21. Then the second band is 51 to 56. So the third stage is 86 to 91. Sun 22nd to 23. Then 57th year to 58th year, then 92 to 93. These are the ages. Moon 24th year, then 59th year, then 94th year. Venus 25 to 27, 60 to 62, and 95 to 97. Mars 28 to 33, 63 to 68, and 98 to 103. Then Mercury 34 to 35, and 69 to 70. Then Rahu 1 to 6, 36 to 41, 71 to 76. Then Saturn, Rahu 7 to 12, 42 to 47, 77 to 82. Then Ketu 13 to 15, 48 to 50, 83 to 85. So in the life of the native, from 16th year to up to 21st year, the Jupiter rules. So same Jupiter rules from his age of 51 to 56, and the same Jupiter rules in his 86th year up to 91st year. So blending with the progression techniques mentioned in Bhrigu Samhita as well as the BPS chapter number 74, that is Sudarshana Chakra, now popularized as Bhrigu Chakra Paddhati, the exact year of the event can be arrived at with the knowledge of Karaka of the event will definitely be associated with the ruler at the time of the event. So this is the beauty of the ruling ages of the planet. So the ruling ages, the Karaka of the event is associated with the ruler at the time of the event. So I will give you the example charts later, but you just make yourself sure and aware of the ruling years of the planets. So this is higher octave or an extended version of the maturity ages of the planets. So the maturity ages of the planets, they have been delineated, they have been studied, and these maturity ages of the planets then when they are studied in correlation with the band of years mentioned in Lal Kitab, this concept of ruling years of the planets has arrived. So this is one of the tools, one of the effective tools for timing of the events. Then we have the progression techniques. Progression is not a transit. Transit is a different thing and progression is a different thing. Progression or regression is an imaginative or hypothetical movement of planet. So what is progression? Progression is an advancement. It is a hypothetical or imaginative advancement. It is not real, but its mathematical precision can be arrived at. So the planets in retrograde motion, they advance in direct motion. The planets in retrograde motion, they advance in backward motion. So progression is for direct planets and regression is for retrograde planets. So either through progression or through regression, a planet gets connected to the other planets through position, aspect or conjunction. Then that gives rise to the event in the life of an entity. This conjunction can also happen through bhavas, through nakshatras or through divisional anchas. So this is very, very important. So progression or regression of three types. You can have progression or regression of dashalord or antardashalord in Vimshottari dasha scheme. You can have the progression of the ruling planet in the band of years. You can also have the progression or regression of a Karaka planet for a particular event. So this progression and regression can be applied in D chart as well as in the Roshi chart. This progression and regression can be applied in the Roshi chart as well as in the divisional chart. So these progressions and regressions are extensively used in the Nadi literature for timing of events, especially in Bhruga Nadi, Agastya Nadi, Kakabhujanga Nadi, Shiva Nadi. So different Nadis are there. So in these Nadis, the Rishis have revealed the concept of progression and regression, and if used properly with fine tuning and subject to certain conditions, it can give you astoundingly amazing results. The results are very, very accurate. You can say you can make infallible predictions using the progression and regression. So you should not confuse progression or regression with transit. Transit is different, progression is different. Before going to the next topic, in my slide of timing events of multiple tools, I have given one more tool that is called as activation method. So what is activation? Activation is independent of your dasha or results or transit. Activation is independent of your dashas or transits. So whenever anything important happens in your life, whenever an important event takes place in your life, automatically the house concerned gets activated. For example, you are going to get married. So your 7th house and 8th house get activated. Suppose you are going to get children, your 5th house is activated. So for example, you are going to learn astrology. So what are the houses for astrology? 2nd house of work is the 5th house of intuition and 8th house of occultism, mysticism and deep-rooted research. So automatically when you start learning astrology, these three houses get activated. You enter a service, you enter a job, so your 6th house and 10th house are activated. You commence a business, your 5th house, 7th house and 11th house are activated. So you fall sick, your 6th house, 8th house and 12th house are activated. So what is the secret? What is the secret of the activation method? So suppose your 7th house and 8th house are totally spoiled. They are highly afflicted, occupied by malefics, the dispositor goes into dustanas, so everything. So irrespective of your dasha, irrespective of your transits, whether any dasha is running or not, whether any transit is there or not, whether any progression regression is there or not, automatically once you get married, all the untoward incidents, all your wranglings, all your frictions start unfolding. So what happens? Your life runs into a rough weather. You may have all sorts of untoward developments in your life. So this automatically takes place once you get married. Because once you get married, your seventh house and eighth house get shifted. Suppose your fifth house is totally spoiled, your fifth house is totally afflicted. Then once your child takes birth, suddenly all the other untoward incidents take place in your life. So you will have all mishaps and misfortunes, etc., related to the fifth. So if unless and until you are married, nothing will happen. Because suppose your 7,000 and 8,000 are afflicted, unless and until you are married, nothing will happen. Whatever dasha may come or whatever transit may come, no, it doesn't matter. But unless and until you are married, the 7th house and 8th house never get activated, and nothing untoward coming from 7th house and 8th house will take place in your life. In the same way, unless and until the 5th house is activated, the malefic results of the 5th house will not manifest in your life. So this is the secret of activation. Then the naughty techniques. I have given this this slide, the title, Exploring the Naughty, Revelations by Rishi. So the naughty is a replete. Naughty is a treasure house of special techniques of prediction. Stalwarts like C.G. Rajan, Jane Basin, B.S. Patel, Gopala Krishna, P.V.R. Naidu, R.G. Rao, R. Santanam, Gunjur Ramachandra Shastri, and many other stalwarts have given us naughty techniques of timing events through their extensive research of naughty texts. Naughty granthas like Deva Keralam, Satrushis Naughty, Bhrugu Naughty, Agastya Naughty, Ravana Samhita, etc. contain many, many advanced methodologies of timing the events. So naughty timing of events are two types. One is transit based and another is non-transit based. So all we have already dealt upon the Parashara transit in the above slide. Then we are here, we are coming to naughty transit. So naughty transit is based on the Karakatvas of planets. One must be thoroughly conversant with the Karakatvas to delineate with precision. I will give you certain examples. Son is Karaka for father. So whenever Sun gets connected to Saturn or Rahu or Ketu, either through position or aspect of conjunction, so there is always a risk or health issues or some other problems to your father. So the naughty transit is different from the Parashara transits in the way that it uses the Karakatvas of planets beautifully. So not only PSC conjunction, even trinal positions are also considered in naughty. For example, Rahu is transiting Jupiter. Rahu and Jupiter are in trinal position. Then automatically, invariably, Jupiter is Jiva Karaka and the native gets health issues. Suppose Ketu is transiting Saturn. Invariably, the person faces issues in his professional life. Vice versa, if Saturn is transiting Ketu, then also the same problem is repeated. So, for example, Saturn is transiting in 8th house from your natal sun. Suppose your natal sun is in Pisces, and Saturn is transiting in Tula. So automatically it issues, it gives life risk or health issues to your partner. In the same way, Saturn is transiting Moon, or then automatically your mother is going to have the problems, health issues or other problems. So there are many such techniques given by Nadi Grantha, especially Devakeralam or Chandrakala Nadi. And you should go to the books written by R.G. Rao. R.G. Rao books, really R.G. Rao should be remembered for posterity, for redefining, for revolutionizing the Nadi astrology through his exploration of Nadi principle. So Nadi principles used always the Karakatvas of the planets are given highest importance. This is the specialty of Nadi. So Nadi transits can be used both with or without reference to ascendant. In Parashara transit, you require the ascendant mandatorily to give you the results. But in Nadi, either with ascendant or without ascendant, the transit results can be delineated. So Nadi also uses the Navamsha positions, Rashi Tulya Navamsha or Navamsha Tulya Rashi. So there are many other aspects. You can go through the various books already written by our rishis or written by our acharyas and written by our modern day scholars. So you can have a very good command over the transits. So when you combine Nadi transits and Parashara transits, so the results will be really astounding. There's absolutely no doubt about it. You just experiment and you will enjoy the fruits. The proof of budding is always in eating. Continuing my slide, exploring the Nadis, revelations by Rishi. There are other Nadi techniques. For example, T.S. Patel, in his books Nadi Astrology and Navamsha Nadi Astrology, has introduced many novel concepts like Bhrugubindu, Bhujangapath, Navamsha Progression, Amshatma Kashtaka Varga, Nadi methods of timing the marriage, etc. So we already know this Bhruga Chakra Paddhati and Bhruga Sarala Paddhati have already been popularized in the astrological fraternity. Then our own Sri Jairam Sir, in his previous presentation, has given us Karma Lagna method and Nadi timing of method as propounded by P.V.R. Naidu. So Nadi, in addition to the transits, Nadi also gives us many other techniques of timing marriage. They may be chakras like Bhrugu Chakra, Padma Chakra. They may be like Bhrugu Sarala Paddhati. There may be novel concepts like Bhrugubindu. Bhrugubindu is a very sensitive point. Bhujangapath is also a very sensitive point. The concept of Navamsha progression, the concept of Amshatmaka Ashtaka Varga. So, very unique system of method of timing, marriages, divorce, birth of children. So, these are all included in the Nadi Granthas. So, as you explore the Nadi Granthas more and more, there will be more and more revelations. And you can enhance your skill of predictions, you can enhance your degree of accuracy, you can enhance your frontiers of knowledge, and you can excel yourself in timing of marriages. So this is the Nadi revelation. So now let us go to the next slide. So, in our journey, experimenting with different tools of timing of marriage, we have touched the dashas, we have touched the transits, we have touched the karakas, we have touched chakras, we have touched progressions, we have touched activation method, we have touched maturity age of planets. We have also touched maturity age of houses. We have touched special Nadi techniques. We have touched band of years. Now we come to Prashna. Prashna is a divine way to divination. In our scripture, it is written that unless the querent approaches a Daivagna, prediction should not be given. So once the querent approaches the Daivagna, there is always a divine link between the querent and the astrologer. That divine link is established. So then only a Prashna chart should be drawn and he should make predictions to the querent. From very, very simplistic Prashna to the most comprehensive Ashtapangala Prashna, there is a wide spectrum of the systems of Prashna prevalent in India. Whenever we think of Prashna, we should think of the Kerala, land of God's own land. Kerala, when we think of Kerala, automatically what comes to our mind is two major texts on Prashna. The first one is Prashnamarga and the second one is Krishniyam. Prashnamarga is the most comprehensive treatise on Prashna. It is the most comprehensive text covering virtually every aspect of Prashna. Then the Krishniyam is called the magnum opus of Prashna. So Kerala is very, very popular in Prashna. So I just give you an example. One of our relatives, he fell ill with backache, with chronic backache. He went from pillar to post, go to all sorts of doctors and medications, but he could not be cured. Then he approached a Prashna, an expert in Kerala. He drew a Prashna chart and said that recently you have cut down the fruit bearing trees. As such, you are suffering from your backache. Then he suggested certain remedies, and once he completed the remedies, his backache vanished miraculously. So this is the power of Prashna. So every system of astrology, be it Parashari or Krishnamurti Paddhati or GMP or Nadi or SP, so all systems have their own unique systems of Prashna. So there are very classical texts like Daivagna Vallabha, Shat Panchashika, Prashna Tantra, Prashna Marga, Prashna Anushtana Paddhati, Krishniyam, Jamakkala Arudam, Bhrugu Prashna Nadi, Kashyapa Hora. So there are, and also the books by many learned modern scholars, they had dwelt upon Prashna beautifully and very deeply. In Narapati Jayacharya, a book written by Narapati in 1322 AD, he said that Prashna should be always combined with Swara and Shakuna. So Swara Shastra and Shakuna Shastra. So what our Guru Shukla sir says, ETP, event time prediction. So this Shakuna Shastra, Swara Shastra and Prashna Shastra, if they combine, as I previously told, you can hit in the bullseye. You can time the event beautifully without any mistake. The predictions will never go wrong. Prediction will never go wrong. So the beauty is you are combining three very, very important systems. You are merging so into a system that never fails. Prashna also employs certain tools for timing of events. They are transits. They may be degree or combination of planets and signs. So there are particular degrees and particular combination of planets and signs. They give results in particular time period, in few days or few months or few years, etc. Then Prashna also employs progression. Progression of Lagna, progression of Chandra, progression of Karaka. Then there are Horani Dashas. They are very, very specific to Prashna chart, like Vimshottari Dasha, reduced Vimshottari Dasha, Trisputa Dasha, etc. Then there are Tajik Yogas. Even in Prashna, there are different systems. For example, Kashyapa Hora, it says that when a querent comes to you, you should see the Hora. And you should see the combination of Hora Lord with other planets. And then you suggest the remedies, prediction, and also timing of the event. Then there is a Prashna Nadi, Bhrugu Prashna Nadi, written This book was written by R.J. Rao based on the classical text of Bhrigunadi. So it also gives you the delineation based on the age of the querent. So this employs a very special method. Very special method of timing the event. For example, when a person comes to you, so when a person comes to you, you should note the year of the birth of the native. Then you should note the completed number of years of the native's age as on the date of the query. Then you have to subtract the completed number of years of the native's age from 107. The remainder will indicate a distinctive number. So you should go to that particular page for making prediction. So this is Bhrigu Prashnanadi. So we have different techniques of Prashna to time the event. So timing of events is not only confined only to Dasha and Transit. So the youngsters or the students of astrology should not be under the impression that timing of events is only confined to Dasha and Transit. There are multiple tools for making the predictions as well as to time the events accordingly. So then there is another system called Ashtaka Varga. So you are all aware of Ashtaka Varga. Ashtaka Varga is a part of the syllabus of both Jyotisha Visharada also Jyotisha. So we are all aware of the Ashtaka Varga. So in Ashtaka Varga also, there are dashas based on Ashtaka Varga, transits based on Ashtaka Varga, and specific techniques of timing prediction based on Ashtaka Varga. Then we have this Varshapala. Varshapala is also a part of our syllabus. You know that how the Varshapala can be used based on Muntas, Sahams, and but specific yogas of Varsha chart and specific dashas of Varsha chart to make the prediction as well as to time the event. Last but not the least is numerology. Numerology is also one of the techniques of making prediction as well as to time the event. Many of us are not aware that numerology has very subtle techniques, very intricate techniques of timing events. Even numerology has its own dasha that is called as Moolanka Dasha to make the prediction. So these are the techniques of prediction which I know. So there may be more techniques which you may be aware of. So what is known to me, I have presented. So let us go. So one by one, first one is Dasha, next one is Transit, the third one is Karakas, next Varshapala, next different Chakras, Progressions, Band of Years, Activation Method, Maturity Age of Planets, Maturity Age of Houses, Advancement Method, Special Nadi Techniques, Ashtaka Varga, Prashna and Numerology. So using these techniques, you can make predictions as well as time the events. Now comes the twister. So correlation of techniques. As a good lawyer who is not only conversant with all the laws of the land, but also able to correlate them and apply them judicially, to present his argument, an astrologer should, in the first place, study all the techniques thoroughly and then get the results synthesized to arrive at definitive conclusions without confusion. All techniques are complementary to each other and supplementary to each other. It is that one technique is an indication, another technique is verification, and the third technique is confirmation. It is just like Sessions Court, High Court, and Supreme Court. So if the Sessions Court gives the judgment, the High Court should confirm that judgment, and Supreme Court should finally says that the judgment is final and binding. So if you know only one technique, there may be confusion. But if you know multiple techniques, and if you have the skill of correlation, synchronization and synthesization of all the techniques, there will never be any failure on the part of the astrologer. Astrologer, whatever astrologer predicts, it comes true in more than 90% of cases. Of course, we are not God. We cannot claim 100% accuracy. At least one should aim at least 80 to 85% of accuracy. So for that, one should be equipped with multiple tools of timing the prediction. Now, I will introduce to you the Bhrigu Chakra Paddhati or Bhrigu Chakra system. So many of you are already aware of this system, but still for those who are not aware, I am introducing this Bhrigu Chakra system. Bhrigu Chakra means the running year of your age, the running year of your age is connected with that concerned house. For example, if you are running the first house is activated. If you are running the second year, second house is activated. If your age is 3, your running age is 3 years, third house is activated. If your running age is 4th year, fourth house is activated. If your running age is 5th year, 5th house is activated. If running age is 6th year, 6th house is activated. So on up to 12th. Again, from 13th, the first year, 25th, first year, 37th, first year, 49th, third year. Second is first year, 14th is second house, 26th is second house, 38th is second house, 50th is second house, 62th is second house. You're all seeing this slide. So whatever is your running year, not completed year, don't get confused. Whatever is your running year, that particular house is activated in the Bhrigu Chakra system. Of course, there are 10 different variations of Bhrigu Chakra system. I do not go into all those complexities to make the matters very simple so that you can easily comprehend and understand the system. I have given the simplistic and the most basic version of Bhrigu Chakra system. So whatever is your running year, that particular house is activated. For example, I am running 39th year. So 12 plus 12 plus 12, 36 plus 3, so third house is activated. It is as simple as that. There should be no confusion. If you are running 51st year, so 48 plus 3, so third house is activated. Suppose I am running 56th year, so 48 plus 8, 8th house is activated. So this is very simple. Then the house is activated, that particular house lord is activated. The planets in the house are also activated. House where the house lord is posited is also activated. And house in trine to that house, the trinal houses are also activated. So up to this, I have completed. Next, I will go to certain example charts. So any questions up to here? Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir. No, so far, we will take up the question later. Sure. I request you to take it forward.
Okay, sir. So, this is the first example chart I am presenting to all of you. This is the chart of my own elder sister who unfortunately expired on the 4th March 2021. So both are South Indian. I will go to North Indian chart also for the benefit of North Indian viewers. So is everybody viewing this chart? Is the chart visible to all of you?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yes, sir. So this is the North Indian chart. So in this North Indian chart and South Indian chart, both for South Indian and North Indian year, the date of birth of my sister is 6th August 1970, 9:45 PM, Mysore. So this is 6th August 1970, 9:45 PM, Mysore. So I will go how the astrology will works wonders. She expired at her 51st year. She expired in the age of 51. So before going to the kinetic analysis or timing of event, first you have to do the statical analysis. That I have told you very clearly. So without static analysis, you should not go to the kinetic analysis. The timing of event comes only after. First, you have to fix the longevity. For longevity purpose, there are many Parashari methods as well as Jaimini methods. So Jaimini methods are more reliable than the Parashari methods, especially for Ayurveda. You have a method of three phase, you have Ruddha Karaka, you have Rasa, you have Kaksha methods. So there are many Jaimini methods as well as Parashara methods and also Nadi methods for fixing the longevity of the native. First, you have to fix the longevity. Once the longevity is fixed, then only you should go to the timing of events or timing of death. So after fixing the longevity, which I do not go into the methodology of fixing the longevity, it is a part of the static analysis. It doesn't come under the purview of kinetic analysis. What my presentation is only about timing of events. So we should only stick to the timing of events. We should not mix up with the fixing of longevity. So the calculation of longevity is another presentation. It is a part of another presentation. So this, when I fix the longevity, it comes to about 48 to 55 years in that gap. In that range, 48 year to 55th year. So she developed liver complications in her 51st year. So why she developed liver complications? Why this is also a part of the static analysis. So it's a part of medical astrology. It's not related to timing of life. So it is very, very clear in her chart, very clear, crystal clear that she has to develop the liver complication. She has to have that longevity only between 48th year to 55th year. So this is the range also fixed by the longevity. Medical astrology also very clearly says that she has to develop the liver complication. So that is part of the medical astrology. Now, let us only stick to the timing of events. So in timing of events, 51st year is 12, 24, 36, and 48, 49, 50, and 51. Third house is activated. So the third lord goes to the seventh house. The third lord goes to the seventh house for Dvishvabhava Lagna. Her chart is of Pisces ascendant. So for Pisces ascendant, seventh house is both Badaka as well as Maraka. So one thumb rule of Parashara that I want to tell you, although it is not a part of this presentation, but one thumb rule. Vadaka is always calculated with respect to Lagna. Lagna is our body. So Bada means health issues only. So Bada for body is health. So when there are any health issues in our body, the body gets upset. So Lagna is our body. So whenever the Badaka's house is activated, whenever the major planets Saturn, Jupiter, Rahu or Ketu, they transit the Bada house or they transit over Badakesh, health issues are invariably observed. So here, the third lord is Venus, is also the eighth lord. So it is a Maraka. It is a first-rate malefic planet for Pisces ascendant. It is Maraka, first-rate Maraka for Pisces ascendant. So when Venus goes to the Badaka house, whenever there is a combination of Badaka and Maraka, it becomes highly detrimental. It can be life-threatening. You should note down this point. Whenever there is a combination of Badaka and Maraka in any way, either through transits or through progression or through activation, or through dasha systems or otherwise. So whenever Maraka and Badaka are jointly activated, that particular period is life threatening. It goes correct in all 100% cases. So here also, the 8th Lord Venus goes to the 7th house of Badaka. So when there is a combination of Badaka and Maraka, automatically she developed very serious health issues. And she was running the 51st year. Again, 51st year, you go to this ruling planet's line. I will go to ruling planet's line. Jupiter is 16 to 21, 51 to 56. 51 to 56. So that means that 51st year is ruled by Jupiter. Jupiter is liver. It is a very basic concept of medical astrology. So you know, we are all aware, we are all conversant with the Karakas in medical astrology. So Jupiter rules liver. So Jupiter is in 8th house, in the house of Venus. Venus is first rate malefic for Pisces ascendant. So the dasha she was running was, Jupiter dasha and Rahu antar dasha. So Jupiter dasha and Rahu antar dasha. So Jupiter is 8th lord. Jupiter is in 8th house. And the dispositor of that Jupiter, Venus, is in the 7th house, Badaka house. Again, that 3rd house and 7th house and 11th house are activated. So I already told you that 51st is the 3rd house. So the trinal houses are 3, 7 and 11. So 3, 7, 11, these trinal houses are activated. And the transits at the time, at that time, you should see that Jupiter and Saturn are in the 11th house and along with Mercury. Mercury is Badaka Lord. So Badaka Lord is transiting the 11th house. Jupiter is transiting the 11th house. Saturn is transiting the 11th house. And Rahu is also in trinal to 11th house. 11th house is Maraka house, as well as it is 6 to 6. Shashtat Shashtasthana. From 6th house to 6th house is 11th house, it is Rogat Rogasthana. So the actually disease gets deteriorated. There will be a deterioration in health condition. And one thumb rule I will tell you, it goes correct without faith, is that whenever the BCP activated house is under Rahu Ketu axis, either in the natal chart or in the transit chart, you can expect certain abnormal or untoward incident in that particular year. So here the 3rd house is activated, and during the transit, the 3rd house is under Rahu Ketu axis, and that house Lord goes to the 8th house, that is 8th house of death. So all these combinations made the conditions deteriorate, and she expired on 4th month. Even Kota Chakra, I am very much fascinated by the application of chakras. So it is one of my passions to go deep into the chakras. Here I am using Kota Chakra. So the Patakirishi Chakra is up to 24th year. So beyond 24th year, you have to go to the Kota Chakra for medical purposes. Even in Kota Chakra also, you see the Rahu Ketu axis. Rahu Ketu is entering her Stambha pillar. So since you are not aware of the applications of Kota Chakra, some other stalwart may come in the future seminar, he may deal with the Kota Chakra extensively. Even Kota Chakra also indicates that her condition is serious and there may be a life risk for her. But unfortunately, she expired on the 4th March. Readers, please note this very, 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 very important slide. From cradle to coffin, Jupiter all the way. My sister's life has been ruled by Jupiter right from her birth up to her death. It is Jupiter all the way. Her birth lagna is Pisces. The Lord is Jupiter. Birth vara is Thursday. It is Jupiter. Birth tithi is Panchami. It is Jupiter. Ruled by Jupiter. Her profession is judiciary, ruled by Jupiter. Her cause of death is liver cirrhosis. Again, liver is ruled by Jupiter. her last dasha, Vimshottari dasha, was Jupiter, Prana dasha. You know Prana dasha. Parashara has given five stages of Vimshottari dasha: dasha, antar dasha, pratyantara dasha, sukshma dasha, and Prana dasha. On the day of death, her Prana dasha, it was of Jupiter. Her nakshatra on the day of death was Vishakha. Again, it is Jupiter. Her avayogi on the day of death, again it is Jupiter. She at the day of death was again Thursday. It is Jupiter. The hora of death again was Jupiter. Karana on the day of death was Garaja Karana. Again, it is Jupiter. Her age of death was 51, and the ruling planet is Jupiter. Her BCP lord in the year of death was Venus, and the Venus Rashi Libra has Jupiter. Her date of death was 4th March 21st. 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 0 plus 2 plus 1 equal to 12 equal to 3. And numerologically, the number 3 is ruled by Jupiter. So it is Jupiter from cradle to coffin. Astrologers may fail, but astrology never fails. So this is the final ratification, how planets play with our lives, how the planets determine our lives, how the planets rule our lives, how the planets control our lives, how the planets dictate our lives, how the planets determine the destiny of our lives. This is the chart for your reference. The next chart I am going to take up is Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of independent India. Jawaharlal Nehru, as you all know, that became the Prime Minister of India on the 15th August 1947. So on the 14th August midnight, he unfurled the national tricolor from the ramparts of Red Fort. It was India's tryst with destiny. And Jawaharlal Nehru said, then ascended the throne of the Prime Ministership, and he was the first Prime Minister of our independent India. So, when we look at the chart, on the independent, he became the Prime Minister in 58 year. He became the Prime Minister in 58 year. Again, you go to the ruling ages of planet. So, in the ruling ages of planet, 58 is ruled by Sun. 22 to 33 Sun. Again, 57 to 58 is Sun. 28 to 20 is also Sun. So, it is also the Sun. So, Sun stands for royalty. Sun stands for political power. Sun stands for royalty. Sun stands for kingship. Sun stands for throne. Simhasana. Sun is the king. So, Sun became the prominent factor in his life in his 58th year. And in Parashara system of astrology, fourth house indicates Simhasana. Fourth house is throne. So, fourth house, you know that it is Simhasana. It is the place of Simhasana. Dasha running was that Moon Dasha, Venus Antardasha. Moon Dasha and Venus Antardasha. Moon is the natural fourth lord, he placed in fourth house. It is Simhasana. He is Kataka Lagna, Cancer ascendant. In the natural zodiac, Cancer is the fourth house and the moon is in the fourth house. So the Simhasana lord is in the Simhasana Rashi. So in the same dasha was running, again fourth and fourth. The Antardasha running was Venus. Venus is in fourth to Lagna, again fourth. And being the Lord of fourth house, he is in the fourth house, again Simhasana. So from Dasha Lord, from Ascendant, from Moon Ascendant, the fourth Lord Venus, fourth house is house of Simhasana, he is in the fourth house, fourth Rashi and fourth Bhava. So again Simhasana. And you look at the normal transit. I am not going to special transit, normal transit, Saturn and Jupiter. So Saturn is seeing the 10th house and Jupiter is also aspecting the 10th house. So 10th house is activated. It is a double transit. You know the very popular system of transit, double transit as popularized by Kane Rao. You know that whenever Saturn and Jupiter get connected to a particular house, that house gets activated. So if Jupiter is in the 4th house from ascendant, he is aspecting the 10th house. Saturn is also aspecting the 10th of Sun. The planet for power is activated. House of Simhasana, fourth house activated in multiple ways. Fourth house is activated in multiple ways. So fourth house is activated in the multiple ways. So Sun is also Sun. Where is Sun? The ruling planet Sun is in fifth house. The dispositor of the fifth house is Mars. So Mars is also aspecting the 10th house. Mars is the 10th lord, and that Mars is goes to old house in Navamsha also. So 10th house, 10th lord, 4th house, double transit, progression, ruling planet, they're all connected with 10th house and Sun. So normally, so automatically, very naturally, you can say that he will have an important position as he became the Prime Minister of Independent India. I will stop with one more chart. I have many other charts, but for the I am constrained. I have time constraints. I am hard pressed for time. So due to paucity of time, I will not go into many other charts. I will end up with the last chart. This is the last chart I am going to show you. A native severely infected with corona in May 2021. So his date of birth is 25th November 1977, 1:15 a.m. Bangalore. So I will go to the North Indian chart. So this is the North Indian chart. So he was infected with corona. So he became, his condition was very critical. He was in ICU. He was in ICU. He was on the support of ventilator. His oxygen level was going down very sharply. Finally, somehow, due to God's grace, he recovered, and he is fully recovered, and he is now very much alive. This took place in a 44th year. So 44th year is 44th year. So 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44. You see here the beauty. 44th year is 8th house. Again, 8th house is under Rahu Ketu axis. How the history repeats itself. So I already told you that whenever the BCP activated house is under Rahu Ketu axis, or BCP activated house lord is retrograde, or BCP activated house lord is in Dustanas, that particular year is very, very, very dangerous. So his BCP activated house 8th house is under Rahu Ketu axis, and that lord is retrograde. So that year, 8th house is of chronic diseases, 6th house of diseases, and 8th house is of chronic diseases, and 12th house is of hospitalization. So he became very, very critical. The corona infection was very severe. And also, the 8th lord Jupiter is retrograde in Mithuna Rashi. Mithuna is our respiratory system, lungs. And the ruling planet at the age of 44 is Rahu. Buddha is for respiratory system and Rahu is for virus. So you check with the corona infection, a majority, if not all, a majority, more than 80 to 85% of the corona infected patients have either afflicted Mercury or Rahu connected with the Mercury. So this is a thumb rule. Here the Rahu was the ruler of the 44th year, and the BCP activated Lord Jupiter was in Mithuna, signifying the respiratory systems. So, and what are the dasha particular? You should also see the dasha. And dasha that particular was Jupiter Saturn. Dasha was Jupiter Saturn. So Jupiter, so the BCP activated house, Jupiter dasha was also running, and Saturn is in the Lagna. Lagna indicates body. Saturn is also the lord of 6th and 7th house and the first rate malefic for Leo ascendant. So Saturn is in Lagna. Again, the Saturn is the lord of 6th house. So automatically, that became very critical period for him. That became very critical period for him. Jupiter Dasha, Saturn Antar Dasha, and Sun's Pratyantara Dasha. So Jupiter, Saturn, Sun. Jupiter, Saturn, Sun. Sun is also the lord of Lagna. So Sun also indicates health issues. So that became very important. And in the transits was Saturn was in the sixth house. Jupiter was in the seventh house, and the Lord of the Jupiter and the dispositive of Jupiter was Saturn was in the sixth house itself. Sixth house of diseases. Sixth house of diseases. So finally he recovered, but you can clearly show how the progression, how the activation here, how the transits, how dashas, and how the BCP all correlated will come to the same conclusion. It is the beauty of astrology that ekam sat bahudha vidanti, ekam sat bahudha vidanti. Truth is one. There may be multiple roads, there may be multiple means of traveling, there may be multiple roads to travel, there may be multiple stools of journey, but the destination is one and the same. Destination is one and the same. It may be BCP, it may be Padma Chakra, it may be Kurma Chakra, it may be Meru Chakra, it may be Tripapa Chakra, it may be progression, it may be advancement, it may be Vimshottara Dasha, it may be Jaimini Dasha, it may be Nadi Transit, or it may be ruling age, it may be activation, it may be Ashtaka Varga, it may be numerology. Whatever the means you can apply, you will reach the same destination. You can go by flight, you can go by train, you can go by bus, you can go by your own vehicle, but the destination is the same. This is the beauty of astrology. My intention is that you should understand this vastness, this greatness, this depth of Indian astrology, which is not to be found in any other system of astrology, in any other world, in any part of the world. The Indian astrology is the richest astrology. It is a treasure house of techniques and methodology. It is, as you go deeper and deeper, you will be perplexed to see its vastness, its greatness, its depth, its wideness. And you will not, you have to salute our Rishis. That is why I have given the title, Exploring the Astrology, Revelations by Rishis. Our Rishis, our Acharyas, our modern day scholars, they have expounded the astrology, and this journey continues. Life is a journey in quest of truth, the ultimate truth. So that journey must continue. I thank Guru Shukla sir, all other veterans, all other dignitaries in the audience, and the entire ECOS team, and especially I should thank Rangachari and Vishwanath Hala for inspiring me to make this presentation. I thank you and all. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Well, great work, Sovaniya. I always thought you are a great speaker, very learned, but so much learned I saw you today. My compliments. And only one addition, just very small addition, regarding this double transit and the Bhagyodaya part of it. After studying a couple of more Nadi books, like Dhruv Nadi, Shukra Nadi, Satya Nadi, now I have come to this conclusion. For exactly calculating Bhagyodaya Varsha, we should see the connection of Saturn, Jupiter, the sixth house, and thereafter, whenever Mercury retrograde, and then you have to see the placement of natal Mars, and particularly the Scorpio and Aries signs, wherever they may be in the horoscope. The reason whenever Mercury and Saturn, they become retrograde, they have a tendency to activate either Mars or Scorpio or Aries. So whenever you want to pinpoint the type of Bhagyodaya, is the tier of Bhagyodaya, so all these factors taken into account,
Yes, sir.
Further zero it down, because this double transit very vast type of quite general thing.
It is very general.
But whenever you want to go specific, then these components I shall repeat for you, because you are very sharp and you will get it. The ninth is what? The sixth house is ninth of tenth. And 10th of 9th.
So it is
the one house which have the capacity to convert Bhagya into karma and karma into Bhagya. So unless you get it connected with the 6th house, you cannot decide at what time Bhagya exactly convert you to karma and karma convert to Bhagya. So both way they are getting connected, number one. And the other part is this Mars and retrogression of Mercury. Retrogression of Mercury, I think you must remember my one of the presentations. It has got three steps, fifth, sixth, and fourth. There, after studying all these transits, previous house, this house, I have come to this conclusion of analyzing about 2000 years data. Whenever Mercury retrograde, it has a tendency to activate either Mars or Scorpio or the Aries.
Yes, you have already said it in one of your presentations.
Yes. So if these are also taken into account, I'll send my paper to you for your further research on it, because it's not complete. I want to further go deeper into it. But since you've done it, presented
it. Otherwise, I would have further gone deep into it, but due to paucity of time, you know, you're all bound to
nonetheless, you spoke very well. So well articulated and so well thought. So by special compliments to Gangachari, then Vishwanath Hola, and Navneet Kaushik, in case he is listening, for making this whole thing possible, and particularly choosing Subramanian today at this topic. I'm grateful to all of you. Because
if you send us PPTs also, I will further carry out my thank you, sir. Thank
one
you for
person is not ICAS. ICAS is all of us taken together. When all of us join hands, like all the fingers, when they join, it becomes a fist. So all of us make together the ICAS.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your encouraging words. So it always keeps us motivating. Thank you, sir. Subramaniaji, it was a fantastic session. So we all enjoyed. All the spectators would have got the depth of your knowledge. So thank you very much for your presentation.
Once again, thank Rangachari, who has been the brain behind all this. Vishwanath Hola, Namnit Kaushik, and other number of persons who are silently working, not coming on the forefront like Manish Malhotra. There are others also. So I thank everybody from ICAS. Please keep on doing this good work. This must continue. And in case you find the viewership goes down, then we can think of having alternate Saturdays. But I shall prefer to have all Saturdays so that we can finish our tribute to great guru Dr. Beaveran as early as possible. So think on these lines. So with these words, I thank everybody. Thank you very much.